Well, Soviets and Soviets of the Red Army, how y'all doing? This is Con Ulrich.
I'm Ringru. Hello, hello, hello.
And folks, today on Orshi East, we have ourselves a new playmate. So Rang, tell us about the old one and the new one.
Well, on the left-hand side in blue, red, I should say, goddammit, we have Grey Fox playing as Polish Home Army, flatline income. Right-hand side, we have Lightrare playing 3rd American Armored Division with Vanguard income.
So the Armia Krakowa, tell us a little, or I'm sure the polls in our audience are already kind of cringing, but tell us a little bit about those groups. What's the deal with them?
We haven't seen them in quite a while. I mean, it's a very interesting division, as it is a resistance fighter division. Lots of very cool infantry stuff, but very light in terms of tanks and anti-armor and actual proper equipment. So it should be pretty interesting. I mean, right at the start, we're seeing this mortar play dropping in some smoke into the central town and just rushing in all of these. Well, I don't really know what all these sort of Russian or Polish infantry do, but they're pretty damn good for the most part, as you really just have all sorts of equipment.
Well, he is bringing the Partizanchi, so I'm happy he's bringing the party. I'm looking forward to it.
Yeah, and the Ochonichi, which sounds like a scratch.
But 3rd Armored is getting overwhelmed. Their infantry is getting overwhelmed. Not too surprising, but the real test is going to be as these tanks start to move in. Again, this 155 off map is already engaging. Ooh, wait a second. Sorry. Down south, we actually have a Scott, an M8, and a couple of engineers diving behind enemy lines here, already collecting quite a bit of territory.
Yes, he is. Yeah. That was a pretty damn good push. I mean, going right through all of that Polish infantry without getting blown up, that was pretty ballsy. But now being on the other side, he can provide a little bit of fire support from behind, but he probably needs some infantry in there, some engineers, for example, to try and clear things out.
We are seeing right now, unfortunately, the Polish infantry here, such as it is, getting absolutely plastered by the 155, and all their earlier gains, I think, are pretty much getting given away.
That's the price on everything.
Rather sad that he's got one of his mightiest anti-tank planes moving on in right now. The mighty Tamin.
It'll get you eventually, probably by the next phase.
Also, I love the fact that the Armada still technically has the insignia for the tank gun, because essentially what it is, the 37 mil. You click on it, you get a nice little tank turret
there.
Oh,
yeah! Yeah, one of those icon things.
Oh, wait a second, we have actually another one coming to the south, too. I think he's looking for the Scott. But bizarrely enough, despite the fact that the Americans are behind enemy lines, they are not officially allowed to hold that territory.
No, they're not. We've got the 50 cows trying to shoot down the biplane. Not going to do
and
much.
Succeeding easily. Scott goes down in the south, just the same time the other Tamin goes down in the middle, but the P-51s and take him out. Lickety split, and just like that, he lickety splits it down to the ground.
Yeah,
what's the whole schwat thing?
It's a hetcher during the Polish Home Army uprising. They meant to capture a hetcher, and they called it schwat. It was like a special
weapons and tactics.
I don't know what it meant, but it was a rather special capture. There's a bunch of pictures of it. Same with other things that the Polish Home Army captured.
I'm sorry, that was maybe a bit of more of an American joke there for half a second. We have the police force called SWAT, so it's a special weapons and tactics. So yeah, sorry. It's not terribly funny if I had to explain it, but maybe somewhere.
If you got a couple of them, we'd have a SWAT team.
Exactly, and that's what I'm hoping for. The vacation, we do get to see a SWAT team. You can see right now the P-51. I mean, the P-51 is almost incredible just to watch this happen.
Yeah.
He, by himself, I feel like, can take out most of this Polish Home Army equipment. Just the aircraft is just so outclassed.
Yeah, it's such a bloody good aircraft. Like, maneuverable, fast, pretty damn good firepower. What's not to love? It's named after a horse.
True, and an unbroken horse, too.
Mm-hmm. Free horse.
With the power of 150 horses under your hood. Lexus, now being sold everywhere. Interesting. Down to the south, somehow Gray Fox has been able to overrun Lightrare. While it doesn't mean that his rear is cleared up, and you're actually going to see one of his anti-tank guns go down, I'm guessing, within the next minute or so. We are going to see them probably clean up the American forces behind the front lines.
Yeah, I mean, we got those two half-tracks there hiding now. I do like the armored rifles and the engineers, but yeah, we got the infantry going into that forest to try and clear things out. Same out, like, where I can't get that armored rifle a little bit north to maybe kill the Schrott.
And that's the thing I'm a little concerned about right now, so the Schrott itself is not really...
Oh, he's moving.
Yeah, he's fine. He's getting past, it looks like. Alright.
Yeah, Grey Fox is doing pretty well for Polish Home Army, really securing that southern side. Doing pretty good at north, and in the central position as well. He really needs to keep a foothold in these town fights, because if he gets into an open field fight against 3rd Armored, he'll probably lose.
It's over in 2 seconds at that point.
Yeah. To be fair, he does have access to 4 whole German heavy tanks, 3 Panthers and 1 Tiger, but you can't really rely on your entire force and only 4 heavy tanks, or tank force at.
Not at least 5. Good idea. Actually, I kind of like this. This kind of, it looked like he's going to drop 2 half-tracks in the middle of it, 2 armored rifles, but they're going to get completely shellacked by this ambush that was set up.
Mm-hmm.
Last second detour and go up and around. I like it. It's such a small modification.
And just completely routing the forest, yeah. So you're going to reap Fiat to get all pinned down, and then maybe armored rifles and hook on in and get some easy surrenders.
Oh, why engage head-on if you don't have to, you know?
Exactly. Yeah, the central position, late rares men to get a bit of a foothold back in GN out of the armored rifles. But this cluster bomber biplane's been pretty on point. I mean, he's got this second one trying to come in, trying to get some sort of eyes on, but never mind. It's definitely on point, because it's going to be staying on the plane forever, just now shot down.
Well, he's just living on a different plane of existence.
Have we never come up with that one with planes?
I have no idea. Jesus. I'm feeling very philosophical
tonight.
There's
so much untapped potential for still, Khan. After 2 years, I'm quite happy.
Well, I mean, war has changed. We must also, so.
Mm-hmm.
Now, kind of humorously, almost up to the north, I say humorously as people die consistently, the digital soldiers, which just kind of dance to our merry tune of destruction. Not been quite as much action. We do have now this PTRD as the lone man on the front lines, save a lot of fire to the north, but there hasn't been much action there, and I can kind of guess why. It's much more confined, much more difficult for 3rd Armor to really play to their strengths.
Yeah, 3rd Armor does have pretty damn good infantry, because M1 Garand, but you don't get a lot of them compared to infantry divisions, so you can't just... I mean, you can spam into a forest, but you can't do it for the entirety of the match. And really, you want to fight more on open ground, because that's where all your bloody half-tracks really come into play.
Can I also just say, I love how the P-51 delivers its bombs. That skip bomb, I don't know why, but I love when an attack craft does that. There's something so elegant.
It's so satisfying. It's just, like, it comes in quick, and P-51 Ultra drop its bombs, it's still a really deadly fighter plane. Gains that extra agility. And he is trying to secure the skies here.
Well, we're going to have an IL-2 slowly turning towards the south. Regrettably, though, the Bofors is going to engage him. And the IL-2 is very durable, but you don't want him to be engaged.
Oh, you don't.
Wait, P-51 might go... P-51 goes down to burst a fire from an IL-2 scout?
What? Well, I was lucky. Holy crap! P-51 did kind of go into his gun sights, to be fair, but damn, what a cool aerial kill!
Down to the south, the last barrage, I believe, from that off episode 155 Sherman OP, is definitely dropping his OP barrage, forcing about the Schwat, and I think we're gonna see the last squad of armored rifles being pushed in. Yep,
that's what he's doing.
And here's the pinch. Here's the pinch. Now, here's a question. Lightrare is playing for an earlier knockout here. Mm-hmm. Does Gray Fox gain anything by trying to play for time?
You don't get a huge amount as the game goes on, to be honest. Riv Poe's B phase is when you get the heavy tanks, and C phase is when some of the Soviet reinforcements come in, such as some T-34s, some T-70s, like artillery. It's really going to come down to Grey Fox's infantry play more than anything, and maybe a lot of it in terms of air power. I mean, he's got the U-2 coming in up north to try and plus the M4A run. I just love how it drops its bombs.
And there we go.
So it's like it looks like a huge carpet bomber and it drops its bombs. So it's just like a tiny little biplane.
Well, let's say a carpet bomber because as fast as it drops its bombs, it's going so slow that it's practically an entire.
You'd lay the carpet.
That got away from me, but you know what I'm talking about.
There's definitely going to be feeling the carpet of the floor as you get shot down.
Ooh,
by
saw that P-51 come out. Yeah.
But to be fair, losing that plane to kill Sherman, it's. Kind of already picked yourself off. And we are seeing the one and only Tiger being brought into the center position.
There he is. Tigris.
Mm-hmm.
And meanwhile, the Tetris theme is playing in my head as the up quarter Korshaw. I don't know. I see that and I thought thinking Koperniki for a second. So now for everyone who's listening, enjoy the thought of Tetris in your head for the rest of today.
Yeah, I will give you credit. I mean, bloody Polish names are pretty difficult to say. Especially with all these weird ones like Partizanskis, Obstrodzis, Mozidon. I'm not gonna shut up now. I'm probably embarrassing myself.
Well, you know what? There was one easy Polish name. It was an older woman I worked with back in uni. Her name was Maria. I got that Polish name pretty well.
That's pretty simple. I think I could tackle it.
It was rare. It took me a while to get it. Only because she didn't tell me her name, although she was just that lady. But actually, I'm trying to think what the Obkor Koroshaw Chi bring. I don't recall what they bring into the fight. You're right. We don't see these guys very often. So no. I'm kind of fascinated because I'm trying to just relearn them as we go along here.
They got one thing I really do like about Polish home armies is the variety of stuff that they get. They got Polish anti tank guns, they got Soviet air power, German tanks. It's got a little bit of everything. And even just the infantry, it's bizarre equipment choices. I mean, the upper Dragowskis have got boat action, rather got semi-automatic boat action rifles with the Mannlicher 95. They got M1 carbines, they got the Czech machine, they got a goddamn Machin. It's just all over the place with their guns, is what I'm trying to say, many words.
That's fair. I mean, we're going to have this OP Sherman coming in to get some eyes on the SWAT, and he goes down almost immediately. But that's why he's there. I mean, it's great to have the machine gun, but Third Armor doesn't need it.
Yeah. Now, that Hatcher is a real good challenger to kill those regular Shermans.
So just watching as the IL-2 is getting engaged here by the P-51 again. Tiger, in the meantime, congratulations, my friend. You're going to kill a half track. Whoop de freaking do. But where is he moving off to? Anywhere in particular? The answer is no. And actually, I'm a little bit nervous about him because it's 76 mils moving up. Very nervous.
It is. Got a mortar half track being brought in down south, which is a fantastic call. Got goddamn mortar half tracks, some of the best artillery units in game. And in a forest fight like this, you can pretty easily clear out what's left of the infantry and stun up that shot.
Unless, of course, he's able to get eyes on.
Mm-hmm.
Which she's not going to, never mind.
Nope. Yeah, Lightrare doing pretty good now, getting a 13-11. He's going to probably go back. No, he's still going to keep control of that flag in the center. But he almost has that central hill completely under his control. And usually, once you do that, you kind of win the match.
But I mean, that's going to be a consistent thing no matter which way you kind of look at it, unfortunately. Mm-hmm. Owning the center ground between two forces is a huge, huge, let's say, bonus. And then, again, another of those moments where I was just distracted by down south as another different kind of Polish infantry being brought on in, the Berlin-Kolski, or Berlin-Gauski.
Yeah.
I can only assume it's the Berlin troops.
Of course, they came straight from Berlin to
exactly
fight the Germans for the Poles.
Oh, exactly.
Yeah.
Exactly. It's like the Volksdeutsche, except the Poldeutsche.
Mm-hmm.
Or the Volkspolia, I don't know.
To fight the Americans in this case, really, which is an extremely bizarre matchup.
Well, at the Cold War, man, it happens sometimes.
Mm-hmm.
But heating things up, actually, a couple of flamethrower troops being brought into the north, the central side, a couple of Shermans down south to kind of really punch through, and this is going to be, I feel like, the beginning of the end for Grey Fox.
Yeah, this is... American armor is starting to ramp up, even though, you know, the income raise isn't looking too great for them as the match continues. But you got so many bloody Shermans referred armored. I mean, it's... His American armor division is going to be Sherman spam. It shouldn't be a surprise. But against a division that doesn't have great anti-tank, his Shermans are a bloody nightmare.
Yes, they are. And even the Scots coming in, the 75mm howitzer, is just going to be not even a godsend per se, but it's just enough firepower to be really, really devastating.
Yeah. I believe, yeah, the Tiger got killed, it seems, which is... You can't really afford to be losing the Tiger like that.
Well, I think it was a 76mm. I'm actually watching down south as the mortar half-track really starts pounding the middle of nowhere for some reason. And then maybe he's going to start engaging this anti-tank gun.
Do you like how our engineer sleeper agent has activated and going to be sneaking up on the anti-tank gun, yeah?
Oh, yeah. Absolutely. The mortar half-track doesn't need to engage that anymore, so he would hopefully not attack his own troops. I'm just watching as these Berlin troops are slowly going to get overwhelmed, especially as these two Shermans come on in. The BTRDs are really quite good, I guess, under the circumstances, especially with the tanks being quite close. But there's still so much firepower on those things that, I mean, good freaking luck.
Yeah. Once again, that mortar half-track hitting... Nothing. I think he's trying to kill the anti-tank gun, but it's been dead for a little bit.
Well, even then, we also have these M2 half-tracks moving on through, and flamethrower troops, yep, finally diving out. Just in the center, I thought behind enemy Luds, maybe to kind of break that open? Not really for sure. But it does look like the Shermans will clean this up in the south, and when that happens, they have, what, the Ocho? To worry about, and that's about it.
Yeah, and once you get into the southern plains, it's perfect fighting fields for the 3rd Armored Division. And heck, maybe our M3 half-track will finally be saved.
He has been chilling behind enemy lines for a while, hasn't he?
Saving Private Burger.
I was thinking more like Owen Wilson's, like, you know, behind enemy lines, but that's definitely true. Yeah. Wow. But yeah, you gotta be really super concerned here, because if you lose these two flags, that's going to be a 19-5.
Yeah.
And that's going to be a sucker punch right there. Not sure just what went down. I think it was that maybe one of the P-51s? I don't know.
I think it was.
IL-2 making a run towards this... Oh, okay, good idea. I thought he was going to make a run towards the anti-aircraft gun. I was like, dude, no! Life is worth it! Don't kill yourself!
Yep. P-51 is going to come in. Oh, it's an IL-2, it's gonna take more than one gun run to kill that bugger.
Well, there's so many IL-2s moving in trying to get after the P-51.
It's too fast.
Good luck, my friend. Too furious. Yeah, that's another sleeper
that
one
right
good. There.
That was good.
Thank you. And with that, the Ocho goes down south, and that's now 17-7. Yep, back to the 17-7. And I'm looking to see... We have an engineer squad in the center that I think is going to get outflanked pretty quickly. The P-51, in the meantime, apparently is just way too fast for this engagement. There's no slowdown. There's ludicrous speed, and there's landing.
He's got the need for speed.
Yeah, he certainly does. But I think just right now, he's putting himself into the danger zone. And I still can't believe that Top Gun 2 is a thing. How?
I know.
How is that a thing?
Hollywood likes money.
I like money, too. I'm still not going to be quite that unoriginal.
Hollywood has low standards.
I'm not going to dispute that. Bofors, in the meantime, going to force back this IL-2, and I think that's going to be a gift wrap over here for this head-to-head P-51, making one more gun run head-to-head.
You can do it, Mustang. No, you can't do it, Mustang.
Oh my gosh, Mustang Sal, you better slow your Mustang down.
Yeah, just take it down 100 kilometers or so. You still exactly. be fast, and you still be the fastest thing in the sky. Don't worry.
Exactly. I mean, geez, again, what, 680? Yeah, dude. Yeah. Chill the F out. Nah, he just leaves. Good. Oh. It's like, you know what? It's too hard. I'm out.
I've done my job. I do like how Grey Fox, he is trying to put some pressure still onto that hill. He's got a lot of sliver of the hill under his control. But the Shermans have a really nice gun line set up. And have no anti-tank, can't really do too much.
And the funny thing is, I feel like if he was able to bring these sabotage, whatever, I'm sorry, guys. With the Panzer Shreks, we're going to see one of them go down here, and there goes a Sherman.
Perfect kill.
When you have the party, and you have the OBS over here, unfortunately, you just don't have the range on your anti-tank. You have anti-tank grenades, which are a little better than me throwing a rock at somebody.
Mm-hmm.
You gotta have that range consistently. It's just it's not powerful enough. It's unfortunately not powerful enough. But 19-5, the Americans control the South. And I don't think the South is going to rise again at any point soon.
No,
and in the North, actually, we're seeing a bit of that big horn start going into the northern side. So, you know, you give the 3rd Armored even a nibble, and they're going to gulp down the whole freaking map.
Yeah. Do you want to take us to times two at, like, 21:50?
Sure thing, sir. And two, one, and times two. And that's kind of pretty much what feels like the tail of the tape, my friends. As the Americans are just going to continue to pound over and over onto these poor Poles.
Yeah. I think it's a pretty good reason we don't see Polish Home Army a lot, and it is because they have a real hard time against... Well, they have a real hard time in general. They got really cool infantry, some other cool, fun units, but you just lack the real anti-armor to deal with tank divisions such as this.
I'm not saying they're like a D-tier division, but it's one of those things that they were definitely put in for flavor, and I really appreciate the attempt to be historically representative, but you can't play with them easily.
Yeah, it is a cool division. I do like having... I mean, how many games like to play as a Polish Home Army? It's not a lot, especially in an RTS game of all things. So it is cool for the historical flavor, but... It's flavor. They're not good in game, unfortunately. Well, I guess it's historically accurate, to be honest.
Well, we have a couple of these biplanes taking out two Shermans. One took out two Shermans. It definitely paid for himself.
Mm-hmm.
IL-2s. I mean, the Poles that are making kills are trading decently effectively. They're not perfect, but they're decent.
Yeah, and losses here.
Not a whole lot to write home about. I think it was just better trading.
Yeah, only a 500 like point difference, which is pretty damn good.
And by the way, yes, a 76 mil took out the Tiger, so not shocking there. But with that in mind, I think that about does it for this particular replay. Any final thoughts?
None. Zero. Nada.
Okay, well, folks, remember to always tip your waitresses. Until next time, I'm Con Ulrich.
I'm Rangaroo. Take it easy.